Testing, testing. Can you all hear me? That's a good start. Well, thanks for letting the sun go down far enough so that I'm not baking down here in your wonderful courtyard. Now, this evening, I've been asked to talk quite slowly. That will be definitely for your benefit. I think it will be partly for mine as well, so I'm not utterly dehydrated by the end. And I do have a tendency to talk quite fast because there's usually so much interesting stuff to talk about. Now, I have with me my iPad. What I'm going to do tonight is present everything from an interactive book. Now, that in itself is a little bit confusing. That means it's something that's produced in iBooks Author by Apple Software. We would normally call that something like an iBook, although we're not technically allowed to call it that. But for the purposes of this, it's so much simpler, so I will refer to it as that. Now, what I want to talk about tonight is the Internet of Things. That's a massively sweeping statement, and something, as we touched on earlier this evening, not necessarily that relevant now. You know, when this was first conceived with lots of devices and people and software all talking to each other, this was about something that actually communicated via the internet. A lot of what I'll be talking about tonight doesn't even need the internet. This is device to device. This is mobile being as mobile as it possibly could be without the need of the internet. And then when you think about the cloud and how everything in the future will live somewhere in the cloud, that's fantastic until you actually try and connect to something. I'm over here, obviously, from the UK, and I can't roam around freely with my mobile immediately connecting to everything all the time. Although, ironically, even when I'm home in the UK, I can't connect to everything all the time. So that's still a way off. But what I wanted to do first was let you know a little bit about me and what I do and the company I work for to make that actually relevant and put that into context, because otherwise I'm just kind of throwing some facts and figures at you all. So the title, as you see here, is Speed Up for Traffic Lights, Bank on Green, Not Red. Now, that's my personal philosophy. I drive quite fast anyway, not breaking the speed limit. However, approaching my attitude to life is approaching a traffic light. I don't slow down expecting it to be red. I speed up hoping that it will be green. Now, that approach applies to pretty much everything we do. And that's about saying, look, if you just take your foot off the gas and you slow down and you take too much time, I will show you some examples of things that actually, you know, they took a little too much time, and someone beat them to get something out to market. Now, this is really important with the Internet of Things and all of those connected devices, because there's a race on at the moment. That race is for wearable technology, amazing mobile devices, and all of that content that sits across that. And a big chunk of that as well is the social networks, the way we all communicate. And that's very much a part of this connected content. It's what we say to each other, and it's the kind of content that, you know, those conversations that revolve within our social networks that, you know, the manufacturers can pick up on. They can create the future from the kind of things that you'll want. However, they're not going to do all of that. They're not going to sit back. They also want to steer it. So, what do I do? I do a big chunk of this. I get to have fun spending time with interesting celebrities, slightly geeky celebrities, go on TV and radio and talk about all sorts of technology. Now, a big chunk of that is what's actually happening out there in the world now, but also a big part of that is about the people that we work with and the type of digital future that we're trying to form here. So that involves design, technology, publishing, and innovation. Now, innovation is a very broad term. Now, basically, that's something that's essentially pushing boundaries. That's something that's delivering something to you, something to consumers that you may not have known that you needed. Now, to many, that would seem that we're almost delivering something worthless. But you think about the iPad, and I will touch on that later. If you all were asked, would you like an iPad? Would you like a big iPhone? You probably would all have turned around and said no. You were presented with something like that, and it became a very different thing. Also, I talk a lot. Which you will notice, and I hope our dear translator at the back there will acknowledge that I'm not doing it quite as fast as I usually do. I get to wave my arms around. I get to do that on stage, but also I get to do that in a creative environment. And a big chunk of what we talk about here is keeping that enthusiasm. Now, that a big chunk of that means as a designer and as an innovator, it's about living and breathing what you do. Now, you know, I love cars. We work with big automotive brands. We work with Disney. Now, that's kind of a kid in a candy store situation where we get to play with all the things that as kids we would love to have worked with. I'll show you Star Wars in a minute. Wow, that's great stuff to work with. And I get to play with gadgets. Now, some of that's just really geeky stuff, but other things, you know, that's things that stay behind a wall of NDAs, working with global tech giants where actually I'd love to tell you all about them, but I can't. So now right back to the beginning, there's a picture of me up here, quite an embarrassing picture of me as a 13, nearly 14 year old. I've been in this business a long time simply because I started very young. Now what was I doing there? I was sitting down for a newspaper article where we'd started our own software company and our own magazine. Again, this was about how do I combine a love for technology and digital content, but also the fact that I wanted to be a designer and an artist. So I got to actually play with all of these things. Now, something that, you know, as a designer, that role has really, really changed. Whereas it used to be about the design, and then it was passed on to someone over here that made things. Those two parts of the job have almost become enmeshed beyond belief, because it doesn't mean that the designer is building things, but it does mean that he has to know everything about the way that it's built. Not, again, not the knowledge that he needs to have to build it, but how people will use it and live with it, and also kind of have the kind of demands they will have once they have that device or that software or something in their hands. So that job as a designer has changed a lot. I used to be a portrait artist. That, you know, just say that, but actually that's what I really wanted to do when I was at college. I wanted to take a degree in fine art, but I realized I'd come out the other end with a piece of paper that said, well done, you're a fine artist. That's not brilliant for the job market. So I was quite practical, whereas most of the time I'm relatively impractical because I like to wave my arms around and do big creative things. I was quite practical about how this was going to lead to some kind of employment. So this was working with all sorts of amazing celebrities, from Michael Douglas to some crazier Apache Indian to Anthony Hopkins. But this was, you know, this was about kind of pursuing my creative goals. But then I started to employ that in the real world. So this became illustration and graphic design for content. It's, you know, looking at how do you promote wind farms in an environment that naturally would show you green rolling hills and blue skies, but actually if it's a wind farm, it's all about the technology that sits behind it. You know, and things down to, you know, how do you bring robots and cartoons and things to life, which moves it on to quite neatly some of the content that we have now. So this, for instance, at Brandwidth, we've produced our own children's book app. And what the only big aim of this was about doing lots of firsts. And one of those was you take a photo of your child at the start, you put their own name in it, and then one of the final pieces is, you know, that becomes their own private little book. It becomes personalized. And you do things that, you know, you wouldn't normally do. You use the accelerometer in an iPad to change the water level at the top. And these are all little touches that, you know, as a designer, you then move on to and create something technical. Now, we've been producing at Brandwidth mobile technology for over a decade. So that means all of the apps that you see now, you know, they started out as applications, amazingly. Now, this is an interesting thing when a big chunk of conversation still revolves around, is this the death of the app? Will everything be mobile, web optimized? Well, of course it will also be mobile, web optimized. But you can't ever say that there won't be any apps, because you're technically saying there won't be any software. And even the internet that you view on an iPad is through an app. So we can park that argument for one moment and say that this is kind of the history that we've had with mobile technology at Brandwidth. And we started out with some of the fun-looking PDAs as we worked our way through to the revelation and that gave us something like the iPhone. And it really gave us the opportunity to push boundaries. Whereas we were essentially gathering bits of data and giving little bits of technical information, we were then able to give a really exciting experience at the other end. And then we didn't test that video before we did this. That was quite loud. That may be just as loud if I play it again. Okay, this was some of the amazing kind of TV and cinema advertising that you produced for Guinness World Records. Now, Guinness World Records will lead us on to something that I will show you in a second. And it kind of gives you the story of how we developed our first iPad app and launched it on the day that the iPad came out. But here's the result of some of that. Now, the first app that you see in the corner there is the Guinness World Records app that we launched on day one. We were able to do that thanks to... I sat down at an awards ceremony next to someone from Apple. I had no plans to do this. However, prior to that, we had said to Guinness World Records, look, your content would be amazing if Apple produced this big kind of iPhone thing. Because essentially they have this big printed book that they produce every year, but they also have video and audio and all sorts of kind of amazing experiences that surround that that never really get seen anywhere other than the very linear TV programs or the printed book. So they said to us, okay, well, that's great. Essentially, you've pitched something to us to go on a device that doesn't exist yet. So we said, okay, well, what we'll do is we'll use a piece of, piece of video, and we'll put that out there into the world and see what the result is when that comes back. So we used a piece of foam board, and we motion tracked and edited some video onto that piece of foam board and made it look the right shape and size to be an iPad. We didn't know it was going to be called the iPad at that point. YouTube went crazy for it. They just said, it isn't this new Apple device. We were then able to go back to the client and say, look, we've produced something here that demonstrates that your audience is hungry not only for your content, but also for your device, for this device. So they said, okay, look, we'll put some faith in this. Go ahead and see what you can develop. So we'd produce something. So this gets me back to sat around that table again at the awards next to someone from Apple. I whipped out a little iPod Touch with the app that we'd developed to that point and said, look, wouldn't this be amazing on your new big iPhone device thing? Okay, yes, it would. So we were able to have just enough information in the run-up to the launch of the iPad. So in the week that the iPad launched, we had final sign-off. Well, actually, we showed it to the client in the US on the Tuesday before launch. They approved it. On the Wednesday, we submitted the first build to Apple. On the Thursday, we submitted the final build with the final beta. On the Friday, it was approved. And on the Saturday, the iPad launched. Now, this is all about that bank on green for traffic lights. This was about not sitting back and waiting and saying, look, let's wait for this thing to come out. Let's just see what everybody else does. We wanted to be there. And it wasn't just about us. It wasn't about us at all, because what one thing that you will notice is most people haven't heard of Bramwitz. And that's no bad thing, because they've heard of all of our clients and they've heard about the things that we've made for them. But that means that, we kept our foot on the gas and we kept going, and we were able to hit the ground running. And that's one of the great things about digital content and the Internet of Things, is that we're able to constantly change this kind of content. We're able to adjust and tweak and change things, because it's not about a printed book that you then have to do a reprint, that you have to plan ahead. We're able to keep changing and keep iterating. So the other amazing wall of things up here, we've got Headspin Storybook, which was a great game that was about... I personally love pop-up books. Now, the great thing about pop-up books is the theatre about this, and it's tactile, and there's some real drama to it. If you then just do a straight translation of that, you end up with something that's not as good as the original. Now, that original was all about that theatre. So what we wanted to do was create something that you could add, but you could only add in a digital environment. So we added a gaming element. So it meant that everything beautifully popped up. It was all mechanical. So there was mechanical elements as well as a kind of the engineered digital paper. But we also added gaming. And that was something you couldn't do within that, the kind of the pop-up book environment. Massively successful anyway. And then there's something here like the Top 100 Albums app. This was about taking something that was a big coffee table book and a series of smaller books and saying, look, this is incredible music to discover. Why don't you play it all through the app? And then if you want to go on beyond the top 20 in each of these decades and build them up to the top 100 of amazing music, you just do that as an in-app purchase. So we were starting to use some of the mechanics of the mobile environment and saying, look, in-app purchase kind of works, and understanding that the audience didn't want to spend all of their money in one go. So we come back to the Internet of Things again. And how do people interact with content, and how do you get them to actually pay for things? I mean, that's a big thing. We have so many models now where you have kind of premium products that make money, but they don't sell in enormous quantities simply because people want the lowest common denominator. Say that common denominator, translate all of that. But they want to everything for nothing. And that's kind of the nature of the app environment at the moment. But you're able to then start nibbling back and start eating back at that by giving people micropayments that eventually top up to much more than that premium price. Then there's Fish that you've already seen. Journey to the Exoplanets. Now, this was about taking an amazing environment and saying, look, what if you could place someone on a planet's surface? What if you could use your iPad to then pan around and look as if you were on that surface? So we had a illustrator that created these incredible 360-degree vistas, and you used your iPad for just that. Worked for Lexus, then Doctor Who, an amazing brand. Again, great opportunity to really bring it to life. And I stood on stage in Frankfurt a year prior to the launch of this and said, I do a lot of wouldn't it be great ifs, and a lot of that arm waving, because that's about, you know, it's not about waiting for a client to come to you. It's not about waiting for the technology to evolve, and it's not about doing that. You know, you always need to be, whether it's your job, whether it's your position, whether it's your opportunity to do something, you need to be thinking those 12, 24 months ahead. And I stood there and said, wow, wouldn't the TARDIS make an amazing navigational device in the middle there? You could spin this TARDIS around, and it would reveal all of the contents that you could go and then navigate into. 12 months later, we'd built a rotating 3D TARDIS as a navigational device for Doctor Who. And then the America's Presidents was something about taking the National Portrait Gallery, the Smithsonian National Portrait Gallery in Washington, and bringing that kind of content to life about all of the presidents. And now we're looking at things with iBeacons, which I will touch on again about expanding this Internet of Things. iBeacons are very much about localized location devices, so that within your environment you're able to wander around with the device and it will tell you what it is that you're seeing at that point. Then amazing musical properties, something like Led Zeppelin as an iBook, The Doors as an app, Demi Lovato, I don't know if that's quite such the same league. And then, you know, within the entertainment business, we're looking at things like Saving Mr. Banks and Maleficent, and these are amazing cinematic properties, and something that can then, you know, be brought alive with an iBook, with a multi-touch book, so much further on than an online website or an app is just too much. So sometimes there's that balancing act in the middle. But then finally, our latest release is Star Wars SceneMaker. And this was fabulous. You know, we say as kids, you kind of think Star Wars is amazing, but then you don't even give a second thought about the fact that you may be working on it. What a great opportunity to create something that allows you to step into J.J. Abrams and George Lucas's shoes and say, look, I want to be the director. I want to create my own version of these iconic scenes. And this comes back down to those micropayments again. It's about saying, actually, let's just offer those scenes as and when we build them, so that we don't just give you everything for a massive price. It's about those samplers and really, really wanting to do it. So very briefly, playing that, I'm not playing lots of videos. Or any with audio at the moment.
I am your father.
No!
Punch, man.
are destroyed.
Let's blow this thing and go home.
Great opportunity to work with Disney and Lucasfilm, and you know, amazing property. Now, I'm not going to dwell too much on these because I've already talked about these. And actually, this was the piece of foam board that we green screened and motion tracked our content on, and this was the version that we did with the IKEA app. You know, that essentially to the internet was the new Apple thing. You know, we were quite surprised, to say the least, that everyone weren't quite so crazy for that. So 4 million views in, and we realised we kind of had something on our hands. In much the same way as we look at things like, you know, how do we connect those devices in the Internet of Things? We connect an iPhone to a couple of iPads, and then we take that content and we may or may not flick that to something like a wrist. Now, this is about making those transitions as seamless as possible, about taking that content so that we're not logging into something else and doing something else with it. It's just those simple gestures and actions. Okay, how am I doing on time? Okay, we're all right. Now, this was about, so if we look at urban environments, now this was very much about, we took something like the launch of a Toyota car as a, you know, a city car, something that very much that needed to solve a problem that we all face within our urban environments of too many cars on the roads, too much pollution, and how do we pose that to the audience effectively? So we worked with the RCA, the Royal College of Art in London, and we posed that very question and said, look, you know, if you were to solve a problem that exists within an urban environment, what would you do? What would that be? Now, you would be surprised how many people designed a chair. I was unaware that that was actually a problem that we faced in an urban environment. However, the creme de la creme, the top, the very best students that we could lay our hands on, decided that they needed to solve the problem of sitting down. The next level, they decided we needed bookcases. Again, not an issue I knew we faced. However, the kind of the better ideas that came out of that were things like ice cube trays that actually had a small lever on the side that allowed you just to pop the ice cube out. These are really simple things, but something that we all kind of bang on a work surface to try and get the thing out. Or it's a lamp contained within just a piece of polystyrene. So the content there is a light bulb, and you're not, the packaging itself is the case outside. And then we had some interesting things like mechanical flowers. These came to life as you walked past, and they were an interesting installation. But this was more about kind of appealing to autistic children and giving something that, you know, that genuine movement and life that worked with sound and movement. And then we've got something that actually was one of the winners, and this was about a bike rack that actually lifted your bike up from street level to a point where people couldn't actually steal it from outside your house, which was thought was a great idea. Now, I'm not going to dwell on all of these. This was about something. Now, I'll talk about seamlessly taking content within our Internet of Things. How do we interact with that content? What do we do with those things that doesn't mean that we're tapping away on a keyboard, that doesn't mean that we're trying to use remote controls? Well, gestural technology. I mean, this is a big thing for us to work with now, because particularly as we start to wear wearable devices, those gestures, the way that that works, not only is it about how a camera might recognize how you move your arms around, it could be about how the device that is being worn on your wrist is being moved. Very simple things, but actually, you know, that this, what on the outset is a complicated implementation, actually the final result is something that is very simple for the user to, you know, we're not typing things in, we're just interacting with content. I'm going to move on, I think. I may stray. If not, I will come back to this. Now, something we've got at the moment that's interesting, particularly in this environment, is an amazing new multi-touch book, Hadid, The Complete Works. Now, I don't know if any of this, if you're familiar with Zaha Hadid, as an incredible architect. Now, she, talking of someone that, you know, really, really puts their foot into the carpet heading for those traffic lights, she was designing and hoping to build amazing installations well before her time. And what's happened is that time has caught up with her. Now, you know, whether you think of all of that time that she spent designing incredible work, was great groundwork for what she does now or not, or whether she was just very frustrated by that. This means that what we've got here is an incredible digital thing that is offering, you know, all of her incredible works right from the start to the finish on something as small as this, which is great. But it does mean that, you know, we're able to work with that content. And, you know, she's a stunning designer. She creates, you know, landmarks for a stunning environment. And, you know, from Saudi Arabia to London to wherever they are, they really are standout pieces of architecture. Now, what I want to do here is very quickly show you now what I've demonstrated very, very briefly here is, you know, how does an iBook work? Well, let's show you how that iBook works in action. So if we open Hadid, we essentially have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pages contained within this one piece, which, you know, we're looking at here, some amazing content. Here, Capitol Hill residence, Moscow, Russia, particularly relevant. But those drawings, we're able to then bring all of that content here, so we're able to work with that. We're able to drop in incredible detail that would normally be in a very, very thick, heavy printed book. Ideal for students of any kind of design and architecture, kind of a essential piece of reference, and then able to annotate that content. But it's a great piece. I'm not going to dwell on this because I've got so much more interesting stuff to cover. But yeah, an amazing title for Zaha Hadid. Now I will nip back into my other iBook. The beauty of not working with PowerPoint. Okay, urban environments, the aim, zero compromise. Now, what does that mean? I can't remember. I haven't looked at this for a little while. Now, what this means is I wanted to give two really good examples here of good and bad thought within design. Now, some of that design, you know, you wouldn't consider necessarily the audio experience as part of that entire design process. And that's exactly what hasn't been considered here. Next week, I'm going to be at the Formula E testing for the Formula E Championships, which essentially, if you don't know about this, it's kind of Formula One with electric cars. They look stunning. It's an amazing environment. It's a great project. And the fact that the whole thing is going to tour the world, but around city centres, also highlights the fact that kind of electric cars are our future, as much as I love the petrol ones as well. But what I wanted to show here, let's just see if we can see what's missing from this, and if we've got audio on this one, hopefully.
What it would be like.
Okay, now it's not just the fact that one of them didn't start, it's the fact that they all sound like little toy cars. Now, if any of you have either been to Formula One racing in the flesh or are fans, you'd know that a big part of that experience is what it sounds like when you get there. The, you know, the fact that you hear the testing before you've even got into the car park to work your way to the grandstand to go and see the whole experience. The sound is something that's completely missing from this. Now, a great example of the complete opposite is Harley-Davidson. Now, Project Livewire is about an amazing new electric motorbike. Now, you know, a Harley-Davidson is, again, all about the sound, the thunder of a Harley-Davidson, you know, hopefully getting from A to B if it doesn't break down in between. The fact that, you know, you hear a Harley coming. Now, this is something they've really thought about here. Hopefully we've got enough audio. Ah, right, now, just in passing. Now, the whole point here was they said, look, we can make an electric motorbike. We can make it silent because it's electric. We don't want to do that. We want people to have the same experience, the kind of the same chill, the shudder down the spine, the tingle that you get, you know, physically and, you know, mentally from the experience of riding a Harley-Davidson. So what they made it sound like was a spaceship. They made it sound like this kind of rocket ship hurtling down the road towards you and going past. They want people to know that there's this Harley coming, and they want the person that's sitting on it to think, whoa, this is amazing. Now, that same experience should be happening here, because they're not appealing to people that would drive an electric smart car. They're appealing to the same people that would go to Formula One racing or watch Formula One racing. There's an essential piece missing there. So this is, you know, these are the small details, and it's a make a big, big difference. Now, something that kind of attaches onto that is saying, you know, when we read content, how do we read it? Now, the tendency now with the Internet of Things is to naturally go to the Internet. So if you're searching for something, if you're Googling something, the first thing you will do is say, right, I'm designing a chair. So the first thing we'll type in is chair designs. So what you'll have is lots of other people's chair designs. What you won't have is the inspiration for a new chair. Now, the thing about a library, now this is great, this is Birmingham Library back in the UK. You know, they really thought, although it does look a bit like a hat box, they really thought about this. They thought about people going in to a library, which is a novelty now, because not many people do it, not as many people do it as they used to. But the beauty of a library is you can randomly go and select something. So if you want to be inspired by colour or texture or the way something makes you feel, you can't type all of, you can't just type colour into Google, you'll get the colours. You can't type how will it make me feel. It probably will give you a list of doctors to go and see. But if you wander into a library and you randomly go, I want to design a chair, and you wander into, I don't know, something about horses, the first piece of inspiration that strikes you might be something that, wow, I can make the back legs of my chair look like a horse. Bad example, maybe. But it does mean that there's that, not necessarily random element, but it's the way that it makes your brain work. It's the way that inspires you to do something based on something else. You will not be inspired to design a red chair by looking at lots of other people's red chairs. Anyway, that's so this is about how you read. So again, kind of coming back to, you know, our series of apps, the majority of those are still reading experiences. They are, apart from the iBooks, the apps are by no means books. This is about absorbing content. You go to the Doctor Who encyclopedia, which essentially is what it is, and there are so many ways to discover that information, from utterly random to spinning a TARDIS to panning around an environment full of content, or to simply typing in a search box if you know what you're looking for. Now, that's a big chunk of the way that people should work with and interact with the Internet of Things. It shouldn't be about you will find it like this. It should be on, or it should feel as if it's on your terms. How will I discover things? And in doing so, how will I enjoy discovering them? Okay, now it's my first list. It's probably my one and only list in this life. I don't really like lists. How do we, it comes back to some of that gestural stuff, how do we actually interact with this content? So rather than, say, getting on a laptop or a computer and typing things in, Googling stuff, you know, what's the technology at our disposal now within the Internet of Things to actually find that content or be alerted to it? So iBeacons. Now, these are amazing little devices. They essentially trigger content. So for instance, you could have an app for a shopping center. Now, every store that you go past within that shopping centre, via an iBeacon, can tell you and give you a compelling reason, or make you speed up, one or the other, to go into that store. So it could say, come in now, there's two for the price of three. No, that's not a good offer, is it? Three for the price of two on trousers, whatever, example. Okay, so I go into that store. Now, within the store, using iBeacons, you're then able to localise the next message. So the message can be, turn left for trousers. Or when you happen to wander into another section, it can be offers about T-shirts. But then when you go up to the till, the cash register to pay, you're then given your final alert, because there's another distance there. And it can either tell you about the final thing. You may also like one of these, or you may like to pay with it with your phone or your tablet or whatever else, or your watch. So iBeacons have a lot going for them. They will work across platforms, so Android and iOS, and it means that they are passive as well. So it means that you are not going to an iBeacon to get some information. They will tell you, in theory, on your own terms, because you will have signed up to actually receive that information. But that in itself, you know, you arrive at the cinema and it gives you immediately, prompts you to what the latest film is, or you may get free popcorn with this film. And then gesture. We kind of talked about gesture earlier and the fact that waving my arms around, I want to just kind of wander up to the window of my bank and wave my arms around, not look as if I want to rob it, but I want to kind of get some information without needing to go in. Now, I don't want to type something in, I don't want to do anything else, but that's a really simple interaction. Now, audio watermarking. Now, this is an example I'm going to show on a piece of video here that normally with an audience like this, I would I'd say download one of our apps. Then at this point, all hold your phones up and you will become the equivalent of that audience waving your lighters in the air. So this gives us the power to create that, but also we can take it a step further. So if we know where you're all sitting, it wouldn't quite have worked tonight, but if we had known your exact seat, so for instance at a concert, at the theatre, you know where someone is sat, you can turn that audience into an individual pixel. So as if you are all part of one giant screen. So imagine that view from overhead, suddenly this entire audience becomes a wash of light and colour. Now, in this environment here that I've got behind me is just in one of our rooms at Bramwith, and this gives you a little bit of an idea of how I would normally have taken control of you all and assimilated you and turned you into my screen. So I will just show you this briefly. Now, the video behind here is actually triggering the devices. So the devices are listening out for an audio trigger to tell them, right, it's time to come on, time to light up, time to do your thing. So all these iPads and iPhones and Android devices in front here are now all working in time with the music behind. So what a great way to involve your audience with, you know, they're already mesmerized by the act that's on stage, but now they can become part of that experience. Now this works here, I mean, this is a great example of showing how, you know, an entire audience can participate with that, but of course that can also work within a cinema or the audience second screening at home. So you don't need to be there for the event, but actually, you know, if that event is broadcast live, that suddenly extends and extends and extends that audience globally. So yeah, you can see everyone from above with the great camera angles. That look, they've been turned into a screen. But look, I am at home joining in with that. Great ways to interact with that. And then augmented reality overlays. So I mean, we're taking things a bit further here and thinking about, you know, we've looked at Google Glass and pursued Google Glass, and we've kind of looked at what's achievable there. But actually, you know, when it comes down to it, the things that genuinely give you information about your environment is something that's overlaid, something that gives you, you know, for instance, I will come to it a little bit later about kind of heads-up displays for cars, environments where you're talking about, you know, I might be cycling, I want to know what speed I'm going at, I want to know kind of what my range has been, and that's all there, everything's displayed in front of you. Again, great, that kind of touching on wearable technology. And then facial recognition, again, it's one of those things, you know, any number of these pieces of technology have uses of good and bad. However, if you dwell on the bad for too long, you'd never do anything. But the facial recognition part is about saying, look, I'm going around a theme park. It knows where I've been, who I am, what I'm doing. But that can be done with anything. That can be just monitoring your mobile phone. But actually, it doesn't know how I felt when I was on that ride. The facial recognition can know that I was smiling or screaming or crying, and it may react and do something else based on that. And then, of course, wearable technology. I mean, that's a big thing, which I will cover in a second. So, Better, I'm going to read this almost for the first time because I've forgotten what I've written. Better digital fabric equals better gameplay. So, you know, the more we make that seamless, the more we make that gesture, interaction, the way we work with something less of a chore, it makes it more about gameplay. Now, it's not about, you know, everyone thinking I'm checking in, I'm doing scores, I'm doing all this, because we'll alienate an entire generation. That's just about the whole process, and it's about that entertainment value, without necessarily knowing you're being entertained, but it sends you away with a smile on your face, rather than a grimace, rather than thinking, that was painful, I don't really want to do that again. But then, you know, continuity leads to memorable moments of emotional punctuation. Well, yes, that does. And, you know, that's kind of about that smile on your face, and it's about saying, look, I want to come back. I really, or, you know, at the very least, I don't object to coming back in your shop or coming back on that ride or using your car again. So, the marvel of mobile and the wonder of wearable. Now, I've got all of 15 minutes to cover wearable technology, which is an enormous topic, particularly back to our Internet of Things. Now, wearable technology, everyone's talking about it. We're not all using it. So, I asked my daughter just over a year, actually, probably about 2 years ago, what's the mobile future? That's not the normal thing to ask, as she was at the time, a six-year-old. They're not, unfortunately, because of me, normal children. But her response was, oh, it looks like this, Daddy. So she put a cereal box on her head, and she attached a phone to it, and she did this. Remarkably, was the forerunner of wearable technology. She was talking about mobile, which to her was already natural. I mean, with the touchscreen, everything, it was natural to have a mobile something with her, whether it was her iPod or playing with my phone. So then, you know, we posed the question to, by this time, both my daughters, and saying, well, what's the wearable future? So, you know, slightly different results. This was option one. She wanted a telescopic eye. Don't we all? But this, you know, what she was saying here was, you know, that's the ability. There is something over there. I want it here. You can't bring it here, but that's the next best thing. And then she wanted an amazing rotating ring that turned her into a helicopter. Why wouldn't you? I mean, this is a big part of that, you know, coming back to the library thing. She didn't Google wearable technology. I just said to her, what's the wearable future? So she just let her imagination run riot. And that's, you know, if our starting point is this blank sheet of paper and we start with the sensible things, we're never going to get anywhere. We want to start with the big things, the big ideas, the big picture. And we get sensible in the end. We have to produce this stuff. And, you know, most people need to make some money out of it. But if we don't start with the amazing imagination, then we're not going to get anywhere. So my other daughter, Hattie, well, she made this kind of thing. She wasn't too happy about it, as you may have noticed. She made a thing that sort of, they were like a pair of handcuffs, and with a twirly thing that was an enormous clock. Smartwatch, bizarrely. I wasn't talking about smartwatches at the time, but this is the thing that she wanted. She wanted something that would tell the time on her wrist, but also, you know, have one of these things on it, which was kind of like an aerial or a funnel or another piece of amazing technology. So, after saying all of that, breaking news, wearable technology isn't the next big thing. And why is that? Because it's been around for a while. So, we look at something like Iron Man, 1960s. We look at the Walkman, 1970s. And then we've got something like good old Casio calculator watch, 1980s. So we can move on to things like this. That's clearly not the most compact flying device in the world. However, that's where we are now. Well, you think about, hang on a minute, we were wearing things like this 20, 30 years ago. Why are we only just getting to something like this? That's kind of our, part of it is down to our understanding and the acceptance of the audience. This is why now everybody is talking about wearable technology. That's what makes it relevant. No matter how many things that you do, or how many things that you make that the audience doesn't understand, it's not going to go anywhere. Now, I've got a good example of that in a minute, but actually I wanted to show you some wearable tech in action. Now, Moritz Voldemeyer, you may not have heard of, you may have. Now, he's an incredible, incredible, incredible designer who's had some marvelous opportunities to work with some great brands that have allowed him to kind of run free and produce incredible things. Now, you look at this. We're talking about wearable technology. This is the epitome of wearable technology. Now, this is where we're coming from. Now, fashion brands are currently over here, and tech brands are all the way over here. Now, what we need for this all to work is some meeting in the middle. Now, I don't want a smartwatch that looks like a calculator on my wrist, although I just showed you one, but that was then. And I don't want a fashion piece that will only be available to a very limited number of people. Perfect for this. I mean, Moritz is showing how this works. You know, this is the kind of theater that can be generated. But, you know, where we need is this middle ground that allows, you know, the consumers to wear this kind of technology. You look at this and, you know, incredible stuff for incredible artists. Now, you know, this kind of thing is beginning to transmit all sorts of content. Now, there's no reason why in 5 years' time you won't all be sat there with T-shirts on that are displaying your latest tweets or whatever you... That's not a euphemism. Or showing something that shows your own personality. Again, you know, let's show how those kind of jackets are then displaying all of these. And great work for Audi. And then even down to the instruments themselves. Why wouldn't you want something that comes to life well beyond its practicalities? So, someone else that's doing that, Neil Harbison, is taking things even a step further. And this isn't about wearable technology now. Although, essentially, Neil is wearing a piece of technology here. He's paving the way for what we'll be talking about in 5 years' time. So in 5 years, we won't be talking about wearable technology in much the way that we're not really talking about mobile now, because everything should be mobile. In 5 years, we'll sort of be saying, well, everything should be wearable. What are we doing next? Well, we'll be wearing it on the inside. We'll be having things that monitor us without thinking about the fact that you're putting something on to monitor something. We'll be communicating via a device that is pretty much non-existent visually. One of the barriers to Google Glass is the fact that, one, you look pretty stupid. Two, whoever you're talking to either thinks that you're not paying any attention to them because you're reading your emails or Twitter or something else, or you're videoing them. So if you have to take away a whole barrier again that didn't exist before in order to get at least back to where we are now. So for instance, if you're wearing digital contact lenses, that removes it. If everyone's wearing them, then we start to forget about those problems that we were placing in front of us. Now, first isn't everything. So this kind of comes back to the fact that we were talking about the understanding of content and the understanding of the way things work. 1985, the Sinclair C5, forerunner of the electric car. I thought it was amazing. I tried one back in 1985, and I thought it was brilliant, but I wasn't trying to drive down the motorway in front of a massive lorry that couldn't see me. So it was an enormous failure at the time. Move forward to 2014, and we have electric cars that still look interesting. They've spent a whole long time when they didn't look interesting. People just thought they looked weird. And that's always going to be something about new technology. And, if you're the pace setter, if you're the person that is the early adopter, then you're in two camps. One is you don't want to look weird, in which case that puts people off. Or two is you want to stand out from the crowd. BMW is a great example here. They've had... the development and the understanding of an electric vehicle or a hybrid vehicle has been around now for a decade. People know what they are. They're comfortable with that. So what they were actually looking for was one that looked pretty good and drove pretty well. And here they are, setting the scene. So back in 1985, no one really... This was like, is this one of those? I don't want one of those. That looks really weird. Well, now people don't think about the weirdness. They just think about, I want one of those. And the same thing can be applied to why the iPad was successful. Well, the Newton, when Apple launched it, was a dismal failure. It was trying to do pretty much the same thing, really, in its own time as we were doing with the iPad. However, No one knew what to do with it. They didn't understand it. Whereas the iPad was launched after the iPhone. So we'd had 2 years of people understanding that you touched a piece of glass, you moved things around like this, you downloaded an app, it connected to the internet like this, it was a mobile thing, and I took it around with me. Now, I touch one of these, I touch a piece of glass, I move things around, I download an app, I connect to the internet, and I carry it around with me. That's exactly the same as what one of those does, except you don't talk to anyone. To be quite honest, I don't really talk to anyone on this. But this is a big one of those. So everyone understood what this was. And that was an enormous, you know, benefit to the iPad. That had Apple asked the audience, do you want one of these? They go, well, someone, all right, I've got one of these. However, they gave everyone one of these, and they went, actually, that's quite good. I'll have that. That's a good idea. So that's a big difference. Don't always listen to your audience, but educate them. Give them a reason to want one. Now, this is very much the fault of the current crop of smartphones. Now, smart objects should be smart. They should look good. This is a little bit like that fashion meets technology part. Don't just give people something because you think, oh, no, they want something on their wrist. Quick, give them something on their wrist. Think about how it looks. Think about how it feels. Think about how it makes someone feel. Now, a chunk of that is thinking about, you know, we have to re-educate an audience. So lots of people now don't even wear a watch because they get the phone out of their pocket and they look at the time on that. My iPhone runs out of power twice a day. My old watch didn't. That told me the time for at least 24 hours. That's one good reason for not doing it. Another good reason is I can't be bothered to get something out of my pocket just to check the time. I just want to do that. And then you think, well, actually, if I'm going to do that, then I want it to look quite cool. I'm not saying that the one on my wrist is that cool, actually, but I've been through a number of smartwatches. The first one, if I connected it to my phone so that it was smart, the battery lasted 2 hours. Genius. A two-hour watch is a bit like redefining time. If I didn't connect it to the phone and it wasn't then a smartwatch, it lasted 5 or 6 hours. Brilliant. That's great. A whole quarter of a day. So then the next one I tried was actually quite good. It's called a Kagito Classic. Kagito Classic. Now that was had an analog display and it had a digital center. So the analog display, the battery would last at least a year. Tell the time. Do what a watch should do. Now then the digital centerpiece would actually just give me alerts. It would tell me you've got a text message, and here is the first few lines of that, or you've got an email, again, first few prompts there, there's something on one of your social channels, go and look at it. They're the kind of things that you need, whereas, you know, suddenly we're confronted by smartwatch manufacturers that want to put everything that's on your smartphone on your wrist. Well, that's a tiny little screen, or it's a massive screen that won't fit up your sleeve. There's one or the other, and actually we shouldn't be having to compromise. So we look at things here. We look at the shine, great kind of activity monitor. They've kind of taken a leaf out of Apple's book and they've created titanium and whatever it is, aerospace grade titanium, amazing piece of design. The lights only show up when they have to. You can't see them otherwise. And amazingly, from Motorola, a nice-looking smartwatch. Although it's not exactly pushing boundaries because it's just trying to be a normal watch but with a smart bit on the front, which doesn't have to do necessarily. And then an amazing kind of, this is on Kickstarter at the moment, amazing sleep monitor that gradually glows and wakes you up in the morning, but, you know, looks great. You kind of want one of those by your bedside unless you woke up out of a dream about aliens, in which case you might worry that you've just been abducted. Now, beyond the device. Now, the point of this really was in saying that we were talking about the iBeacons earlier. Now, all of the hardware, that's all great, that's all fantastic. But the Internet of Things is still about that communication. So, you know, here's the illustration of saying, look, I'm walking past the store, reason to come in. Now I'm in various sections. It will tell me, you know, what other offers there are. and then we go up here and I will pay with the device. But also we're kind of thinking about e-ticket entry. So you go into the train system, you go into anywhere that you would normally need either a card or money or some kind of access. And again, it's about that smooth transition to get you through. And then back to the wearable future. So how does that look? You know, what are we doing with those kind of things? Well, we've got stuff here. Okay, let's look at the devices for the Tour de France. Let's look at those kind of bits of heads-up display. But also, you know, when you're in that kind of environment, that fast-paced environment that doesn't allow you to go pushing all the buttons to doing all the things, how do you immediately display that information in front of someone's eyes? Or, you know, if you take it out of this environment and you put it into something like a supercar environment, a high-powered road car that you then want to take on a track, you're sat there with your glasses on and it's overlaying the ideal driving line and it's giving you all your information. This is, you know, there's a lot of play on fun stuff here. And it's not necessarily about being the most useful, most practical thing that you will ever need, but it's about giving that extra layer of experience. And then taking someone around a museum with that kind of overlaid environment and saying, look, this is what you're looking at. It's not taking an old device with headphones on, or it's not saying, here is your smartphone, now do something else with it. It's about just giving you that overlay of information as you work your way around. And then also down to storytelling. So, you know, you think about how we tell stories at the moment. This is something I've been in publishing for, I will have been in publishing for 30 years next year. As I say, I started young. Now, currently, we think of a book. Even with those digital examples that I've shown you there, that for fiction, that reading experience is very well, you know, it's very set in its way. Now, there have been lots of experimentation about how do you then extend that with transmedia storytelling. Let's translate that one. we have something that will kind of sit across multiple platforms. Now, that works for our Internet of Things, but does the audience actually want that? I still enjoy, even whether it's a Kindle, mainly a Kindle, just black and white, there's my book, I will read, I will allow myself to be absorbed into a piece of fiction, that's great. However, if we're able to then take that on a level, and we're able to say, right, well, what can we do with that? It's another education piece, it's about saying, no, there is another step you can take with fiction. And it's something like this. Now, there's another piece of video, and I might need a bit of audio, so I don't know how loud this will be. This is a project we've been working on, called The Numinous Place. Now, Mark Stauffer was the head of production at Universal Studios in London, and he moved to LA, decided he wanted to be a successful screenwriter, became a successful screenwriter, as you do, but then wrote his first novel. And he said, well, I've written my first novel, but I want it to be bigger, better, and more amazing than just a novel. I want it to be interactive in some way. So he spoke to us because he'd seen some of the work that we've been doing, and together we were able to create something that didn't disrupt the narrative. Now, this was very important. It was about saying, now, how do you take that regular reading experience that everyone understands, and rather than just bombard them with lots of things and drop lots of content over the top, how do you make that seamlessly integrated? So this will show you how we've integrated it on an iPad. However, you take the kind of the ripple effect is you take that out beyond the boundaries. And it doesn't mean that I will send you here and you would do this and I will go over there. It just means that you're able to extend that by using, you know, digital billboards on the underground, by knowing that someone has walked past because of the near field detection on their phone and saying, right, that piece of information will be displayed relating specifically to you because I know you're on page 286 of your book.
I want to tell you a few things. I want to apologize for not being completely honest. I knew what I was getting you into. My daughter will explain. You can trust her, but don't trust anyone else, Hank. No one.
The church was here long before the scientists and their machines.
A supernatural thriller set to revolutionize storytelling. Share the chilling journey to the afterlife and back. Reveal the greatest conspiracy of all time. None of us are who or where we think we are. Hold on to your seat and open your mind. The book just evolved.
Again, fun stuff. But it's, you know, a big part of this is about that education process. In much the same way as you needed the iPhone before the iPad, you need to, and why should I wear a smartwatch when I don't wear a watch? You need to then explain in what seems like the audience's own terms, why do I need more than just a regular book? We don't need that for every book that you read, but there will always be those titles where you have that great opportunity to take something from, we're not trying to make a book into a film, that's a film. We're not trying to make it into a game, that's a game. What we're trying to do here is just give that extra depth and excitement to it. So, I haven't got much more here, which is good. Now, what I wanted to bring with me was Oculus Rift. We're doing some amazing stuff with this. I didn't bring it with me it always looks really dodgy taking it through customs. It looks like I've got some kind of night vision goggles and I'm going to be taken off into a small room and searched with a rubber glove. What we've got here is something like Oculus Rift. And if you think, you know, if you put yourself in this headgear and it transports you into an environment, that's amazing. You kind of, once you've tried it on, you never want to play a game or interact with something in another way again, which is quite sad because it almost means that I'm not particularly bothered about the humans that were beyond the headset. But the piece that's missing is saying, well, that's great, but I'm not in there. I can't see my hand. I can't do anything with that. So what we're doing is we're using iPhones to turn them into lightsabers. So you place yourself not only into the middle of Star Wars, you use your iPhone to become the hand that moves around wielding that lightsaber, and you have the battle in there. Fantastic stuff to do. And again, it's all about not, you know, we could have just said we settle for the thing that we have been given. But no, that's not good enough. What we want is to take that on to the step we do that. But then the next step that we want to take that to is then place other people in that environment, because of course, a lightsaber battle on your own isn't much fun. So you want to have that with someone else. So, you know, lots of possibilities, amazing stuff. And, you know, Oculus Rift gives us a great opportunity. I know Facebook have bought them, so there's all the concerns about what will that turn into. But actually, what that gives them is a whole load of money. And some of the first conversations have been with film studios about saying, you know, place me not into the film, because I'd be pretty quickly travel sick if I watched a full-length film, but give me part of that film, give me an experience. Why can't I be Spider-Man between the towers and flying through the middle of New York? Why can't I be my hero in that film? Well, of course you can. This gives us all sorts of amazing opportunities. Now, that's a relatively quick journey around the Internet of Things without telling you exactly what they all were. But there's an amazing world of connected content out there, connected devices, amazing platforms, but none of it is amazing without incredible stuff on it. So that's a big part of what we all have to play is, you know, if you're not creating it yourself, it's a great opportunity to tell people what you want. You know, forget about those barriers. This is the digital world where we can pretty much create anything we want. Now, the thing we have up here, if anyone's interested, anyone has iPads, free to download is Digital Publishing The Next Steps, which gives a brief outline of what I've talked about, some of the things today, from wearable technology to publishing to all the things, all those digital goodies that are coming out, and then a range of all of our other things. So that was me. I hope you enjoyed that. Thank you.
Есть ли у кого-то вопросы для Дина?
Извините по-русски. Представьте себе, пожалуйста, следующую картину.
See, the technology has baffled me, clearly.
Представьте себе следующую картину. Тысячи людей одели...
Oh, I need more volume, sorry. Is it meant to be actually in my ear? I can. Testing. I have you. Okay, thank you.
Не хватает слайдера, да? Раз, два, раз, два, раз, два. Крутилка слишком старая. Скажите, пожалуйста, как вы себе представляете картину? Вот 1000 людей одели Google Glass, да? Ходят в этих очках. Взяли мобильники в руках, в руки, да? У каждого в руке по мобильнику. И каждый себя изображает, чувствует Люком Скайуокером. И представляете, это где-нибудь в Москве, в Нью-Йорке и так далее. Вот идут 1000 Люк Скайуокеров. И они взаимодействуют интерактивно. Вот я, вы, там, еще кто-то. И вот каждый идет вот с этим мечом. Они в своем мире, точнее, мы в своем мире, да, там где-то вертолеты носятся, где-то там монстры бегают и так далее. Как вы вообще к этому относитесь? Насколько это может пагубно повлиять на цивилизацию?
I love it. I love it. It's perfect, apart from the Google Glass bit. That's the bit that we need for that is the full glasses that you can see through with augmented reality, and then we can unleash the Jedis to run around Moscow. I think, you know, it has a positive result as long as you're not using real lightsabers.
Извините, как комментарий. Много лет тому назад мой знакомый перестал играть в игрушки, в автомобильные симуляторы, когда недалеко здесь проезжал, перед резким поворотом подумал, надо засейвиться. Когда он проехал поворот, он подумал, я больше в эти игрушки не играю. Это к вопросу о том, что все джедаи.
Yeah, I can sympathize with that.
Есть ли еще у кого-нибудь вопросы к Дину? Что ж, тогда на этом мы будем заканчивать. Спасибо большое всем, кто пришел, и Дин, спасибо.